My dad had to go take a shit one time. And my mom told me the story. Went to 7-Eleven, ran inside and asked the guy, "You need a toilet?" The guy said, "Nope, no toilet." Damn it. Dad bought a roll of toilet paper. Told my mom, "Mary, I got to go by the dumpster." Said, "All right, Lawrence." My dad ran around the dumpster. And my mom said she pulled the car around. Came around. She said, "Man, I turned that goddamn corner. And all I saw was your dad's ass sticking around the dumpster." My dad, got back. Goddamn, Mary, I almost didn't make it. I said, "Lawrence, what the hell were you doing?" I said, "Man, I got to take a shit. I had to go, Mary." "You're behind a goddamn dumpster. Hide your ass next time. Hide my ass. I'll hide my face. People are looking at my ass." Okay. All right, guys.
All right.
How you doing?
How you doing?
Yeah. We got our beers, too.
Yes. Yes. Cheers.
Beer time.
Yes.
Take two.
Take two.
Yes, sir.
Everybody, I'm Johns and Josh. And I'm on some fucking talk show.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Wasted Space Podcast.
You are on the Wasted
Welcome
Space
to
Podcast.
Wasted
we are happy
space.
To have you here.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the one and only Jonathan Joss. You may know him from his big roles in King of the Hill as John Redcorn.
Yes.
Of course, one of our favorites, Parks and Recreation as Ken Hotate. also, just one of the most... One of the most badass motherfuckers on the planet, too.
Yes.
So,
a great show, man. A great, great fucking show.
We're chilling. We're talking. We're having... How was your day? What'd you do today?
Man, straightened up the house, stayed up kind of late, went and picked up the mirror pod.
That's a good day.
Now, do you... obviously, you born and raised in San Antonio...
house is behind me. My mom and my dad. My dad built it for my mom in 1957. It was just a little small house, made it a little bit bigger. I fucked it up and tore it up, trying to put it back together. I got acre land back here.
That's awesome.
I got fucking 6 puppies and 8 other dogs, man.
Dude, we got a lot of pets over at our place too. It's a
yeah.
We have a little mini zoo in our house. We have
I usually play the Redcorn music.
Fellas, I'm ready to get up and do my.
You hear that?
Yeah.
Yes.
I want to get into it, man. You
the
know.
Brian, you got to see the guy before rock and roll.
Man, yeah. Moving, doing it. You know. Can I count?
So
out?
Let's come on your fucking show on instant.
Get up, get on up,
yeah.
Get up, get on up.
Man, if you were late, if you were out of time, he docked your pay. If you're 5 fucking minutes late, 2 minutes late, he docked your pay. And he was telling the band, "Hey, man, y'all are slacking." What the fuck he was, man. The band was late. Band comes in late. All you motherfuckers are fired.
Yeah.
How you gonna fire us? We're the band. He'd been rehearsing with another band for months.
Damn.
But, yeah, man. Thanks for having me on the show.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we're so happy
we
to have you.
We have a lot of cool stuff going on, man. You know, always problems, always difficulties in life.
Yeah.
I know I talked about a little bit, you know, earlier that, you know, during a period of darkness, man.
Yeah.
You know, I like calling it the war on freedom, man.
Hmm.
And I think, you know, the purpose of a patch on a pirate, when you went down below the deck, you would take the patch and move it over to the eye. Because your eye has an adjustment. So a pirate would have one patch. So if you would go down below the deck, he'd switch over. So his pirate eye would automatically go to the darkness, adjust to the darkness.
Okay.
And I think what happened to us during a COVID period, a lot of things changed, man. People changed. Ideas changed. The thing about change and darkness is not being aware of it, trying to ignore it. So after that period, man, what we think is the light now, I mean, they always say the light is the end of the tunnel, but the light ain't down the tunnel, man. We were so shut down that we don't realize that, we're not 100% again.
Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
And I don't know if we can take 100%, man.
It'll take a long time.
Yeah, we're definitely nowhere near out of, you know, what we've been in.
What were you accustomed to? Like, me being who I am now might be too fucking overwhelming. You know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
I totally get that, man.
Yeah, I've become, like, so much more antisocial since lockdown and stuff like that. You know, I'm much more of a homebody now, whereas I used to like to go out and do things, but now I prefer to just chill and take it easy.
I mean, I could never live a normal existence, man. I could not live without some type of fucking drama.
Yeah.
I get overexcited. I get overdepressed. I get butthurt a lot.
Right.
Yeah.
And some people don't like that, man. Some people, you know, want you to be a little more manly, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't think we're out of it. I don't think we're ever going to be out of it. I think we got the PTSD. Yeah. You know?
It's at an irreparable point.
Yeah, life is different now.
You can only try to make it better, but we're not getting back to normal by any means.
Oh, dude. I mean, I tell myself, you know, fuck, man. It took me to be 56 to get married. And I fuck it up in 2 years. What the fuck, man? There's a reason why it took so long. You know, and as you know, everybody wants to point fingers but being who I am, what I am, and who I think I am, people tend to fuck with you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's intentional, but it's out there, man. I mean, everybody's at a hustle. Everyone's got a fucking hustle.
Yeah.
Am I being paranoid? Fucking not being paranoid.
Yeah.
Of course. Like any fool, I put everything on fucking social media, man. Because the reason that's where I turn to get help, man.
Yeah.
Because I know there's someone listening.
Mm-hmm.
Because everybody wants to hear what you got to say, but nobody wants to listen to what you got to say.
Yeah.
100%.
It's nice to know that I can make people laugh and I made changes in their life. But that's how the world's gotten to where they want us to ignore our emotions, ignore our feelings, and ignore what we perceive. What I perceive is real, man.
Yeah,
I don't give a fuck how fucked up I am. If I perceive it within my existence, okay.
Mm.
I have a right to feel that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, good. You feel that way? Good. Okay. We understand, Jonathan. But you could be wrong. But thank you for acknowledging my people. I mean, and that's the issue that we're having in today's world, man. You have people. I mean, hey, come on, man. If you go into a bank without a mask, they're scared of you.
Right.
So it's just acknowledging it.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what? My wife will tell me to shit, piss, jump. I'll listen to my old lady. When my old lady's wrong, she's right. When she's right, she's right. Again, people are afraid of the dark, and now people are afraid of the fucking light, man. We've changed a lot. I've changed a lot. I mean, I'm losing the best person in the world to me. And I can't blame anybody but myself.
Mm.
Maybe I should have stood up more, sat down more. I've never had a fucking relationship work anyway. Probably because of me. But to be within my life, you're not going to have a quiet life.
Mm, yeah.
My wife once said, you know, you Google my name, and the first thing that comes up is, who's my wife? Huh? But it also says I got 4 kids and worth $3 million. Remember the ex-girlfriend one time, as we broke up, she said, are you sure you're not worth? What the fuck, man?
Oh, my God. You mentioned that you had a podcast that you were working on yourself. Is that?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
You want to tell the people a little bit about what that is?
Sure, man. I spoke about it to a lady doing an interview within my management company. Mm-hmm. And she kind of liked the fucking idea. During COVID again, a lot of people spent time at home, man. A lot of things happened within our structure. Like you said, you became a homebody.
Right.
Yeah.
People weren't going out. People weren't doing stuff. If you weren't home whacking off, that was a problem. Male or female.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And during the COVID period and my delusional mind, all of a sudden, I found myself watching webcam artist.
Mm. Yeah.
And it grew, man. Right, there's several different, I guess, platforms. You start watching it, and it wasn't a dirty feeling by any means. I was like, you know what? These people are actors, man. They're entertainers. For those that all acknowledge what they do, those are the people that I'm going to concentrate on. There needs to be a platform to where these entertainers can be interviewed. It gives a sense of freedom that somebody acknowledges who they are. The idea of helping somebody else out, helping myself out, bringing awareness.
Mm.
You know, I spoke to my management team about it. You know what? Howard Stern, man, there's no reason why I could not be the king of all adult podcasts.
Yeah, 100%.
No, it's not easy being 56, 57,
mm.
57, man. Not feeling attractive, not feeling that you're living up to someone's expectations or living down because of your own actions. A little acknowledgement goes a long way.
I think we lost you.
I'm sure he'll call back. For the time being, I'm going to...
This is Wasted Space Podcast.
We'll be coming right back in a second.
We're kicking it with Jonathan Joss.
Full of brewskis. Got them brewskis.
Brewskis.
Getting Bud Lit right now.
We're brusking it up. Yeah, we're getting Bud Lit.
Bud Lit.
All the angles.
Show every camera. Yeah. Maybe hide the label because we're not sponsored.
This is brown bottle beer.
Brown bottle, blue label beer.
Brown bottle, blue label. It's beer.
Hey-o.
Hey.
There we go.
There we go.
Oh, you're in the hot tub now. You're chilling.
Hey.
Oh, nice.
Where's our hot tub?
I do. I wish we had
one. It's definitely a catching concept. Do you have like a name and everything picked out for it?
Oh, of course, man. My big pecker. No, I wish. yes, man. It the whole idea of branding is you discover it, kind of like America. So this is right now what I would be called in making. There's an episode, like I said, when I told him I was doing John Redcorn. There's an episode where Hank shows up at his house, and John comes out in a tuxedo, and he says he's going to a gala. And the gala that they're speaking about is the Porn Awards. And he makes reference. He tells Hank, would you like an organic Pop-Tart? So I will, within my podcast, I will debut or interview or feature a certain number of entertainers.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to concentrate on the single performers as opposed to, you know, the multi groups.
Right.
Male and female, transgender, whatever you want, you know, whatever folks vote. And it'll be basically a gala and the organic pop tarts.
I love that.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that that John Redcorn quote, the with the pop tart. Is that your favorite John Redcorn quote, or do you have?
Oh no, man! My favorite John Redcorn quote is "You had dreams about my sweet nana."
Yes,
I love that. I love that.
What
scene.
What about the iconic character of Ken Hotate? Do you have a favorite?
You know, Ken was created through Greg Daniels. I saw Ken as a sophisticated John Redcorn.
Mm.
Okay. Yeah.
And when I got the audition, I did, and I fell in love with the character. Man. You mean like Firewater?
Absolutely.
We
yeah.
fell in love with the character too. I mean,
of course.
Oh man, such a character. Oh, those suits! Holy fuck, man! Suit they gave me the last one I did. I was wearing a Bill Blass vintage Western suit, and I was with a buddy of mine who I kind of coined the character after. I was walking off, and he goes, Jonathan, I'm like, what? Are you going to return that suit? Are you returning my land?
Did you hang on to any of those bolo ties that they gave you?
Yeah. My friend sells on Etsy. He's such, this is embarrassing. Yeah, man. Yeah. I got married in a bolo. It's up on the wall.
That's awesome.
Did any of those bolo ties, were they your personal ones that you brought on, or did they give?
No. They had a couple. My dad loved a bolo tie, though, you know. But it was such a fun character. I remember the first episode I did. I have on the wall at Park and Recreation how Pawnee was built.
Yeah.
And it was built on the back of Native people. Mm-hmm. And one of the ideas was that a Native guy had an affair with a white woman, got him pregnant, and that was how, you know, Pawnee was kind of spawned.
Yeah.
But they have them getting married. And then you see a cartoon character of the woman pregnant. And the next thing you see is the Native guy standing in front of a cannon.
Oh, yeah.
I remember when I first saw that, man. I just stared at it, like, forever. And sure enough, when I came back from lunch, I had it covered over. So in the episode, you walk by and it's covered over.
I know you probably get asked about it all the time, but you did that movie with Chris Farley and Matthew Perry. What was it like working with those iconic actors as well?
Now, everything I got is a fucking story, dude. Went in, living in L.A., got the audition, last-minute audition. Hey, man, can you make a last-minute audition? I was like, sure, I can make it. So I get a call for this audition, and then, hey, Jonathan, can you make this audition? Right down the street, Burbank. On Buffalo Bundy at Santa Monica Airport, like 5 minutes away from the motherfucker. And they're like, you know, you need to be there in 30 minutes. I was like, yeah, I can make it, no problem. I make the audition, I get there, and I pull up, walk in the office, and there's an older white man behind the desk. And he looks at me and goes, oh, are you here for the Native American part? Oh, you a fucking genius. So, Mr. Guest will be seeing you. Who the fuck is Mr. Guest? Oh, Chris Guest is. Fuck, man. Director, dude. I know that. White guy to me. Walk in office. And there's that motherfucker. Sitting there.
Stone cold.
So I don't say a fucking word, man. Emotions me. Bunch, sit down. Stand up. I'm talking about slapstick comedy. Now it's all about timing. Not about words. It's about a beat. Within that beat, timing, beat, bump, and he's doing the lines. We come in peace. I'd read the script. In peace, we come in peace. Bump. He slaps Chris Hardy. So he comes around the desk, kind of patronizing, like, and just right up to him. And we come in peace. As soon as he said it, I slapped that motherfucker.
Just right across the face?
Good one. Oh, fucking face!
Oh, man, I love that.
I tried to slap you on the ass. He took the joke. You know? He went with it. He saw me come at it. You know, he went with it. I mean, the guy's one of the greatest comedians, man. Slapstick is all about it, you know? So he saw it coming. And he took it, took the momentum, went back to his desk, and this is, now, Jonathan, Acting is acting. He said, thank you for coming in. I walk out the door. Didn't say shit. I got outside and went, motherfucker, man, I'm gonna call the police on me. Well, as I'm getting there, the phone's ringing in my apartment. I was watching. I ran up the stairs, got on the phone. My agent, what did you do? I said, oh, fuck, they called the police.
They called the police.
I fucked up.
It was a joke, I swear.
So they told me, you got the job. What? You got the job. You're on private jet with the crew tomorrow morning. Wow. First time I've ever been on private jet. Chris, that Mr. Farley sat in front of me.
You didn't slap the pilot, did you?
So as we're taking off with the plane, you know, all of a sudden, Chris just jumps around. That man in a little jacket. My attorney said for me not to answer that question. You fucking director, I'm on the slap. I met Chris years before in San Francisco. And I'm walking in the room. I'm walking to get my key. And I hear, hey, Jonathan. That's Chris, man. Like, almost hiding. So, being comical about it. I mean, how the fuck do you hide a fuck guy? Yeah, yeah. Tell me. I'm like, yeah, what's up, Shorty? He goes, can you do me a favor? Oh, yeah. He goes, can you go get me 2 snooker bars? You mean like acid, right? He goes, no, snooker bars. You mean drugs, right? He went, no, snooker bars. He goes, like a real snooker bar? He goes, yes, a snooker bar. So I go, where? He goes, you gotta go to the bar. All right. So I go to the bar. I get 2 vodka and cranberries. That time I drank vodka. I was sophisticated. I get 2 vodka cranberries, 2 snooker bars. We get them, and all of a sudden, white guy. All my story ends up with white guy telling me what to do. And white guy goes, what do you think you're doing? Me? You know, not hello, chief, nothing.
What are you doing?
I said, dude, I'm getting drinks and some fucking snacks. He goes, this thing has alcohol. Native American, fucking drunk here, dude. 2 drinks. What? Who's snicker bars for? I go, those are for Chris. Do it. He can't have plenty bars either.
So that's why he was being all secretive.
I look over at Chris and Chris is like, the little old man, you know, Blue, you're my boy, Blue! The old guy from,
Old School.
From Old School, yeah.
He was around when the dude created AA. That's how old that motherfucker is.
Really? Holy crap.
Anytime you're on a movie set with drunks, alcoholics, they have to have a, what do they call it? Coach, whatever. A sponsor.
Sponsor, yeah.
He was Chris Farley's sponsor. Oh, man.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Wow. Obviously, another one of your iconic roles is Denali in the Magnificent Seven remake. Now, I also noticed that Chris Pratt is also on the cast for that. Was that related? Did he help?
Yeah, I cut his dick. Why not big? I don't.
Was it just a coincidence or? Hell yeah.
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 Hell yeah.
I was at a park and recreation party, and like one of the first ones, and Chris and I were talking, and wonderful man. So we're sitting there drinking. And, well, a year later, there I am at the bar, different restaurant, and there's his wife at the other end of the bar, and there's Chris with everybody around him. I remember one day I asked him, I said, he had a Volkswagen, and he had problems with the air in the back, air cooled, getting hot. I heard him. I said, hey, dude, I said, what year? Oh, I go, it was a 68, 69. I said, really? I said, they put a transmission in from a 70. There's about a 2-inch gap, and that seal won't work. You got to do a custom seal. You got to put the original transmission back in. You're always going to overheat. Right. Give me fucking phone number. I called him. Motherfucker didn't answer. About 2 months later, I see him. Hey, Chris, you want to? Oh, man. He goes, I got to work out, man. He goes, I landed a Marvel Comics movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Guardians of the Galaxy.
So I see him, and there is everybody's around him because he is the flavor of the month, man. Making $20 million fucking film, man.
Yeah.
Saw him, and I yelled at him. Chris! Hey, buddy! I'll see you on Magnificent Seven. He laughed. I was just talking my ass. I get auditioned on the street for, and I will go, and all these fucking dudes all mushy, big motherfucker. Fuck, man. I went in to audition, and the lady said, hey, she goes, they've offered the role to long haired guy. Fuck, I worked with him on Almost Here. I mean, puppet. The Hawaiian guy. Real good looking Hawaiian guy.
Jason Momoa.
Yeah, Jason Momoa. Yeah.
That was just a guess.
Oh, no.
I'm surprised that was correct.
Did you just drop the AirPod in the hot tub?
I think I was number 11. I was 11 on the call sheet, man. And only the top 10 have respect. I was number 11, mother.
Oh, man. Oh, man. Just out of the respect range.
So, I go in, make up. No big thrills, you know. People doing stuff, talking to other people, you know. Yeah. And, fuck shit. And I was having lunch in my regalia, sitting there eating by myself. And I see Chris. Chris, hey, Jonathan, how you doing, buddy? Holy shit, you knew all along. I said, man, I did not know. He said, yeah, you told me you were going to work. I said, no, I said, I'll see you. He said, what? I mean, I'll see you at the fucking movies. I know I'm going to be in the goddamn movie. When I got that job, man, I auditioned on Wednesday, I think. And maybe a Thursday. But anyway, I was fucking broke, man. Had no weed, had no beer.
That's a struggle, yeah. We've been there, dude. Yeah, that's
sitting in my fucking car, man. Literally fucking crying, dude. I'm like, oh,
been there.
Phone rings. Ooh. My manager, are you crying?
Fuck yeah, I'm crying. Really? I'm a human being.
Don't be depressed anymore. You know, they offered you $90,000. You got the job. Then I really started crying.
Yeah, I bet.
Hell fucking yeah, dude.
And I got the gig, man. And saw Chris there. He came up, gave him a big ass hug. I mean, good man. Good man.
Mm.
Good hugger, too. And didn't think much of it, man. Ate. Had to go do touch-ups after lunch. Walked into big hair and makeup. Hey, Jonathan. Before it was Denali. John, who the fuck's Jonathan? Oh, me? Oh, yeah. Hi. Would you like a hot towel for your face? You have a hot towel? Boy, the hot towel. Put it on your face. Is that some tea or coffee? You have tea? Oh, spot of tea.
Take tea, tea and coffee.
You have a crumpet? Oh. Yeah, man.
Fire water?
God damn, man.
Yeah, man.
What happened? Hey, oh, no. Chris is here. And he told us that we better treat you good.
Oh, that's awesome, dude.
That's rad.
That's what I was telling you, man. If in life you can't somehow contribute, I mean, everybody can contribute to someone's not being happy.
Yeah. Mm.
But if my existence can somehow make them feel better, help them get an acknowledgement, this thing I'm doing now, man, the lady that I talked to, the young lady I talked to today, man, basically pitched her the idea. I said, listen, I said, the concept that I have to help bring awareness and bring credibility to what you guys do for those who want it. You are an entertainer. You are an actor. I mean, what you guys are doing now, come on. Howard Stern makes millions of dollars at it.
Right. Yeah.
And is he any better than you guys are? Fuck no. You know?
Well, we're glad you think that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Come on, man. I mean, because, I mean, you guys are ballsy and are doing this, man. I mean, you're the dick and you got two balls each side of you.
There we go.
Yeah, that's what our friends always say, too.
Yeah.
On top of your podcast, you also mentioned, I know you have spices. You have John Redcorn.
Yes, man. Starting back up. I'm going to relaunch next week.
Nice.
Hell yeah.
Basically do a phone in order. I'm going to do like a 4-week launch where I just do phone calls. Between 9 and 12.
Now, yeah.
Give me a call. I'll talk to you. Tell you a funny story. Place your order. I take your money. Mail it out. So right now we have to go do a platform and do this and do that. And the only reason I'm selling is because people want the autograph and, you know.
Right. Well, and I'm sure the spices are bomb as fuck, too. I mean,
you can go to jonathanjoss.com. You can place your order there. I've got John Redcorn, King of the Grill, 7 magnificent spice blends. Before you light your fire, before you buy your meat, get you the grill rub that'll make you king of your grill.
Do you have a favorite? What's your favorite spice out of the 7?
Mexican meat rub.
All right.
Okay.
Yes. The jalapeno kicker, the chicken clucker. They're all amazing for the reason that they're all based out of San Antonio. The company is. My parents had a restaurant here in town. I was a fat fucking kid. Love food. The reason I came up with the idea was for the reason that King of the Hill always brought people around the table. And what, you know, I love to cook. Makes me think of my mom.
Yeah, man. I mean, it just gives you a way to share with your family, man. And I mean, whether you're cooking for yourself, I mean, I make tortillas now, man. And I remember my mom was telling me, make her tortilla. I said, oh, buy some, mom. I'll never have to make. Fuck, though, man. I'm here by my fucking self and, you know, and trying to find something to do to make myself cry. So it's soothing because, I mean, who doesn't like to eat?
Yeah.
Yeah.
100%. I do it every day.
This is interesting. You have to think of the concept that my mom owned a restaurant, man, and incredible cook. My dad would go out to eat, and my dad bitch about it. Mary, you know, it isn't as good as you make. You have to realize, I mean, I've been told, how do I know when you say you love me, you love me? You're an actor. That's what you do.
Right.
And my mom would tell my dad, but Lawrence, you know, within any industry, just because you do it every day and you're good at doing it every day, you may not want to do it at home. Mm-hmm. And that's the catch 22 about anything that we do, is that if you make it your living, someone has to suffer. And usually the people at home are the ones that feel neglected, because my dad would say, man, Mary, you cook. But Lawrence, you know, I cook every day.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like if you work.
I was just saying today, like, I used to work at a car wash, and people was like, why is your car not clean? You work at a car wash. It's like, I don't want to clean my car. I just clean everybody else's. I'm tired. Yeah. I'm burnt out.
Absolutely ridiculous.
So and it's more not just be with anything. It's just getting in deep with it. And then, you know, and asking the fun questions. I mean, you guys ask fun questions.
Oh, I'm glad.
You got fun questions, you know, good answers, and you have questions, and you got thought process to it. And that's the good thing about being interviewed by people that know how to give interviews. You study, you write the questions, you have an interest in what they're saying.
Mm. Yeah.
You're interested instead of being interesting.
Right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. That's a really good way to put it.
And it allows your audience, you know, I mean, think about it. The Johnny Carson show. Who knows about Johnny fucking Carson? Who about the people over there?
I know that you graduated with a BA in theater. What is your all-time favorite play? Your favorite play?
Oh man. I love The Tempest. Played Caliban. For an actor, doing Shakespeare and being being an actor who look ethnic. Mm. Shakespeare was written for the common person.
Mm.
If you look at Shakespeare, you've done it. You can do it in African wardrobe. You can do it. You know, it's all about that iambic pentameter. And the characters are there. Where they come from isn't important. For example, in college, when I did The Tempest, we did it with the kabuki theme. We all had a Japanese wardrobe on. I always enjoyed Shakespeare for the reason that you had to watch the word. I mean, I didn't want to be a film actor. I thought film actors were fucking lazy. I didn't want to do it. And then I did a movie. And 8 Seconds with Matthew Perry. And got like $3,000 for one day. I went,
that's pretty good.
That's not bad.
Fuck to be or not to be.
Yeah. Fuck yeah.
I know you were born and raised in San Antonio, and then at some point you obviously moved to Los Angeles. Did you what was like the biggest cultural kind of difference you noticed between the two cities? Because I feel like they're kind of vastly different.
Yeah.
Holding the door open for somebody.
Okay.
In LA. Open the door and they go, what? Oh no, I got it.
Dude, that's fucking hilarious.
Oh my God.
A lot of people have mentioned that they have wanted like a reboot for King of the Hill, but I disagree. I think it'd be cool if we got kind of a John Redcorn spinoff show.
Oh, dude. They were up at Southwest Texas State University. There, you okay? Up at Southwest Texas State University, they have the archives.
Mm-hmm.
And supposedly there was a concept of them having a bleed over. I could fucking completely agree with you, man.
Hey, you you also mentioned you mentioned to me yesterday over when we were talking that there's a dog shelter in town that you're
Yes.
Yeah, that's amazing,
man. Tell us more.
I'm working with a woman and her family. It is not a nonprofit. You're in a lot of difficulties with a nonprofit.
Yeah, for sure. Mm.
She feeds the strays. She has houses them, and she's been wanting to do this for her son as well. And I have a lot of dogs as well. And she got my number. We talked. And what I'm going to do is I pitched her the concept of doing like a 15-minute infomercial, basically, about who she is, what she does. My goal is we have a theater. We have a place called the Draft House. They show independent theater movies, locally owned. And I'm thinking that would be a great place to have it pitched. You show it, even if it's 10 minutes, you know?
Right, yeah.
And at the end of it, ask for contributions, you know, address where you could donate. We'll ask them to leave them, limit their funds, you know, $5 or $10. Her goal is to build a kennel and do some other things. So I like the idea, but I'm going to approach it in almost a mockumentary type of way, almost like Parks and Rec, how they do the documentary format.
Right.
And it'll be a day in the life of her. We'll start with a daylight shoot, a night shoot that has her preparing for the next morning, what she does before she does her runs. But most importantly, you're going to meet the dogs.
Yeah.
I'm going to give the dogs voices. Voiceover.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Roxy.
Nice.
And then talk like about that. What their life has been like before and what their life would be after.
Okay.
And of course, you got to put little footnotes. There's not the actual dog's voice.
Yeah, right.
There we go.
If you need some extra dog voices, please let us know. Yeah, we would be happy to help out.
That'd be awesome.
Oh, man. Yeah, yeah. What we'll do, I'd like to do, you know, be able to, you know, show it to you guys and talk. I mean, the woman's wonderful. Very nice lady. I mean, my dogs are all I have, man. I didn't want them to begin with. The ex-girlfriend bought them, and I got stuck with them. oh, man. Kitty.
Yeah, we got a bunch of cats in here, yeah.
It makes me stay home at night. It makes me have a reason to wake up, you know? When I think that, I think, oh, you know, fuck.
Yeah.
Tomorrow's not that important. I think, you know, how about these poor fucking dogs?
Yeah, hey, man, that's like, I do that all the time. Like, I have a cat, and I wake up, and I'm like, sometimes I'm like, man, I don't want to get up tomorrow. There's nothing like nothing for me. And then I'm like, oh, I got my cat and I got stuff, you know, so.
Yeah.
It makes you feel good. It really gives you like a reason. And it's awesome.
It does.
I got 6 or 7 more little pit bull boxers, man. That
I had a pit bull boxer for a couple years.
I'm going to give away 3 tomorrow. They're good, big size dogs. So they should be easy to give away because they look. She doesn't really mate with anybody. But one time I came out and there was a pit bull across the street wearing a tank top and a chain. Serious. He was like, what's up, man? I'm going to fuck your bitch.
Oh, my God. Before we start wrapping it up, I wanted to ask specifically about, I'd love for you to tell your Chuck Norris story.
Yeah, Chuck. Chuck, baby. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I saw Chuck a couple months ago.
Really?
Really?
And he remembered me. He said, I remember you. The scene where I walk up to him, he puts his hand out and stops me. And I tell him, we don't want your kind around here. I'm supposed to stop. And he put his hand out, standing on an apple box. He's standing on a fucking 6-inch apple box.
So he's short as fuck, right?
He's short, yes. Put his hand out. And as I stepped into him, his elbow buckled. Michael Priest, the director, cut. He goes, now with Chuck. Put his hand out, man. It's a hand of God. And Chuck's like, so can we just shoot? So I'm walking toward him, and he doesn't change. Puts his hand out, except this time, as he puts it out, kung fu shit.
Oh, yeah.
Motherfucker, got me right. I just a little. Dude, air came out of me, man. I mean, he knocked the fucking wind out of me. I mean, I've been kicked in the chest, and done off horses. This motherfucker knocked the wind out of me. like, oh, this kind of shit. Boom. He got me right there. And just, oh. And my line was, we don't want you kind of right here.
That is
get the van. Crazy. And he's sitting in the fucking van in the front seat. Chuck Norris? I go, what the fuck was that? He's like, Chuck Norris.
Chuck Norris.
We wanted to ask because I found some sort of, it seemed like you had a producer role in some sort of alien.
Yes, man. It was a low budget film shot here in town. Low budget for everybody else, but I got paid like a fuck out of it.
Yeah, that's what's up.
There you go.
Dude, it was nuts, dude. It was fuck. I mean, great crew, great everybody. Fun little film. There's one called The Wraith Within, which is about a woman, a young girl who's murdered by her dad, and comes back as a wraith and starts killing every fucking buddy.
Oh,
shit.
Oh God.
And this chick can walk on all fours like a fucking spider, a backwards.
Oh, jeez.
Wow.
Scary shit.
Terrifying, yeah.
Super scary.
I'm a producer on that as well. And I play her best friend, who's a native kid. He's a young man. And he's got the big speech of, I watched my best friend die by the hands of it. I was a good scene, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And the reason I get producer credits on it is because within the union, if I don't get paid union contract, as long as I'm a producer, I mean, I get paid better than union, which I'm really proud of. Mm. I've done my wife and I did two music videos that we're really proud of.
Oh, right on.
Okay.
I'm getting ready to start the dog one. And then I'm going to do a video for myself from an old CD. Redcorn Still No Good. Oh, no. I'm talking Redcorn Still No Good. I'm not sure which one I'm going to do, but it's basically going to be me chasing myself around. And it will represent my different personalities. Mm-hmm. And then at the end, they all come together.
What are your personal beliefs on aliens?
The truth is out there, man.
Yeah.
I don't think that we're the smartest creatures.
I agree.
You know, no, I think aliens are out there. You know, they do exist.
For sure.
But what the fuck they want to talk to us about, you know?
Yeah. Right. I know. What do we have to say that's interesting to them?
I mean, yeah, but before we get it going, I mean, is there anything you want to promote to the people? Where can they find you? Let them know your cameo, where they can find your spices.
It's JonathanJoss.com, or you can go on Facebook, order there, or just hit me up on my phone number, man. My phone number's there. Give me a call, and I will take your order personally. What we're doing here, I've been working on this concept. It could be a very expensive one if it's not done right. As for the viewers, to understand that sometimes you got to believe in yourself. You got to believe in your ability. I've been working on this for a couple of weeks now. All right, ladies and gentlemen, to end this wonderful podcast, I do not advise anyone to do this because I am a trained drunk. Guys, thank you so much for having me on the show. Appreciate it.
Coming on the show.
Thank you for my fans that will listen to this. Thank you for digging in deep and listening to me.
Dude, thank you so much for coming on the show. We've been lifelong fans.
Okay, folks. Here you go.
Here we go.
There's Tom Martin. After on the show. That wasn't close enough. Drum roll, please. Good job, baby.
Hey! We got holes in our pockets where our money should be, baby.
And the idea was to line them up in a straight line. Still no good. And if you see them, straight line, bend the phone.
That's what I'm talking about, man.
Thanks so very much for having the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, the legendary Jonathan Joss, the one and only.
That being said, keep your eye on the motherfucking target.
Hey, that's what I'm talking about, my man. Right. We are definitely going to have you back soon. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you. Hit it and quit it. 1, 2, 3, 4. We out. Bye.
Hey, Oh, I was going to have him do the high five with us, but okay. Well, guys, that was... Let me pee, and then we'll do an outro. Let's do this outro. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the one and only...
Jonathan Joss.
Our good friend now. Good Jonathan friend, Joss. Yes. Yeah.
The homie.
Can't wait to have him on in person someday soon, hopefully. Yes.
Spice Spices, King of the Grill. Go to yes. JonathanJoss.com Make or sure hit him
to
up
go
on
support
Facebook.
Jonathan Joss.
I'm yeah. looking to. I'm looking forward to trying that, what do you say, Mesquite, which the Mesquite Barbecue? Rub?
Yeah, Mesquite Barbecue, I think so.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to trying that.
Yeah, we're going to try all of his spices. I recommend you pick them up. He also sells autographs on his website, JonathanJoss.com.
Yeah, I believe.
Go support him. He's an awesome guy.
Yeah, I believe with every one of your spice orders, he sends you a signed either John Redcorn or Ken Hotate, whichever character that you prefer. Mm-hmm. He'll send it to you. And
yeah, so hit up his website. Go check it out. He's got TikTok, right?
Yes.
Go check out
his
TikTok.
On TikTok at Original Redcorn. So make sure you find him there and
support a living legend.
Dude, yes. We had such a fucking blast talking to him. He
so
is
so much fun. He's so funny.
One of the funniest guys we've ever met. Obviously a staple character in two iconic shows in our
absolutely,
lives.
Absolutely, yeah.
So it was just an honor being able to talk to him today. And next, tell us who you want
yeah, who
us
should
to
be
interview
on next?
Next.
Who
should
be
we
next?
Get next?
Comment below.
You tell us.
Let us know.
We're going to link our Patreon. Our Patreon, fuck it. We're launching Patreon with this episode.
Patreon.
I just,
doing
we're
doing
about
it. To get our Patreon.
We're about to get our Patreon on. But no, seriously.
Yeah, check out our Patreon exclusive content.
Yeah,
all
when,
that jazz.
When you support the Patreon, you support more guests on the podcast.
Yes, and we appreciate absolutely. It. We want to bring as much content as we can, get as many guests as we can. So your support is appreciated.
Yes. Thank you guys a bunch. Once again, make sure to like, comment, subscribe. Every subscription and follow comes with a free long distance
high five,
motherfuckers.
Boom.
Let's go,
boom, boom,
bitches.
Boom.
We will see you
around.
Next time. This has been the Wasted Space Podcast. You have been... the fucking audience.
That's true.
Oh,
very true.
And we also had Jonathan Joss on here. I don't know if we mentioned that.
Yeah. I don't know if you, yeah, if you yeah, noticed that by now, but we did. So.
Ken Hotate.
Boom. Peace. Peace.